Morning, everyone, and welcome to the Paraworld Sailing Committee at this 2021 Annual General Meeting of World Sailing. We have an agenda in front of us, and thank you, Massimo, for your introduction and for the roll call. I think our only apologies have been from Jens Croker, who has been serving on one of our working parties, and I would also like to welcome to our committee Heiko Kroger, who is the new Athletes Commission rep. We look forward to his work with this particular committee. Just before I make my opening remarks, I'd like to ask if anyone on our committee has any declaration of conflicts of interest other than what has been submitted prior to World Sailing. Okay, it doesn't seem like we have any on that. And then I do would like to note that we have our two vice presidents on the call, Marcus Spillane and Corey Sertle. And I'd like to open the floor to either of you if you'd like to make any remarks to the committee before we get started.
Thank you, Betsy. Very pleased to be the vice president along with Marcus, supporting the great work of your committee. Like to extend my thanks to you, Betsy, as chair, and to all the committee members. I've been very pleased to be on many of your meetings and following your progress, and happy to support and looking forward to hearing more today. So that's all I have today, Betsy. So thank you.
I was on mute. Thanks, Corey. Marcus, would you like to say anything before we dive into the agenda?
Nothing to add. I think Corey has said it perfectly. Thank you very much for all the hard work, and good luck with this meeting, and look forward to hearing from you all.
Great. Thank you so much. Thanks for your attendance. Well, I'd like to welcome everyone to this meeting, committee members and observers and World Sailing staff that have been supporting us. It's been quite a year. Last year was crazy with the pandemic and COVID shutting down all of our functions. And I would like to thank our committee for the hard work. We've been meeting monthly since the start of the year with the new committee, and it's been a fantastic collaboration and work. As noted by several other committees during the course of these meetings, it really has been notable the lack of human connection in face-to-face meetings. And I think that is something that we all wish we had the ability to do. And I know I personally look forward to the time when we can meet face to face. So much work is done pre-meeting and post-meeting in the hallways and in between meetings with members of other committees. And I think that really helps facilitate a lot of the business of World Sailing. I think we've done a great job of that during these COVID times, and I would like to thank the observers and class people and everyone who has contributed to the efforts of this committee. This year, a lot of our work and focus has been surrounding the, back the bid for LA 2028 and that re-inclusion, and that work continues to be a significant part of what this committee is working on. But I do not want to dismiss the other work that has been engaged on during the course of this year. And we will be hearing from our various working parties as to that work that has been conducted. And it has been everything from work on classification, on equipment, on rankings, on inclusion, and inclusion events that have been happening around the world. And to be honest, I am so impressed by the number of MNAs and participation at para events and open events where sailors have been attending and been getting ranking points and supporting the parasailing initiatives and agenda. So kudos to all who have participated in these robust activities during the year 2021. I do want to also note it was not added in the agenda, but and that was an error on my part, was I wanted to note the minutes and accept the minutes of the 2020 AGM. They were circulated to the committee, and I would like to open the floor if there are any comments or omissions that this committee sees on those minutes. If we have none, we will accept them and move on to agenda number two. So before we move on, does anyone have any comments or additions to the minutes from 2020? Okay, none noted. So we will accept those minutes and move on to agenda item number two, which is reports from the members of our working parties. So Massimo will note the members in our minutes, and I would ask that each of the leads of the working parties just mention who is on those working parties for the viewers that are attending our meeting today. So Bernard, why don't we start with you and have you give us a brief update on the classification working party.
Yes, hello everybody. On the working party, the international classifiers was Walter Meekle, from Adrian Stogel, Lynn Beal, Massimo Deeglin Dunn, Megan Griggs, and myself, Bernard Estrin. Further to my report, I would just have is that in 2021, we classified 75 sailors, some of whom had already been classified. They're not all new sailors, but we have seen a great increase in the number of countries and some new sailors coming into the game, which is really very encouraging. I would also like to add that thanks to from the Power World Sailing Committee, we have been able to improve the database that we're using for classification. It will drastically improve the speed and the accuracy of the master list, which is published on the site. And so very, very shortly, we'll have a new master list that'll be very exact and mirror the reality of our classification. Over. Thank you, Betsy.
Thank you, Bernard, for the great work your group is doing. I know it's a challenge during these times from a travel perspective, but you guys have done a great job of getting new classifiers in the mix and getting athletes classified. So thank you for your work during these pandemic times and through the challenges that we've faced. Let's move on to the equipment working party. Alfred?
Yeah, welcome everybody again. The Equipment Working Party is representing as well the Power World Sailing Committee in the Equipment Committee and the Equipment Rules Subcommittee. I have a report to these two equipment. I think everybody has been reading through it, and basically the work in equipment is as well very much on better and more intense cooperation with the classes. And I think this is the biggest issue at the moment, the biggest point we are working on, and everybody is contributing to that, from athletes, representative Heiko, to Betsy, to Massimo, to everybody, because this, I think this is crucial, and this is our main focus, I think, for the next year. Thank you.
Thank you, Alfred, for that. And I expect that we will be having some discussion in committee as we move further on the agenda about equipment and you know, what we can do to support the sailors and to you know, increase participation and the involvement of sailors on the ranking list, which is the next working party that you actually chair. So I'll let you speak to that as well.
Okay, on the ranking working party, as everybody noticed this morning, a new website from World Sailing was up. And so I'm still hoping that the IT project of the new rankings is going on now a little quicker than before. Actually, what I was doing and working with Massimo on that, I was trying to have a ranking for all the three sanctioned classes that we are using. It's the 2.4, the Hansa 303, and the RS Venture. And so that we have at least some overview of what is going on and who is leading and what we'll be doing, who will be doing well and which countries and how many sailors from how many nations and so on. I think Massimo can go on with that. I submitted a report on this as well. There are the detailed numbers. And I think a proper ranking is still a very strong argument. It's important for the sailors because they can look it up and they're happy to see, let's say every month at least, or every week better, where they are now in the rankings after the races they have been sailed on the weekend. And on the other hand, a proper ranking is as well a strong sign to IPC. I think that's it, just a short summary on that. Thank you.
Thank you for your work on that. I know it's been a massive lift in terms of making sure that those rankings have been accurate and updated. So thank you for your work on that, Alfred, and for Massimo's support on that. Let's move on to our communications working party. Yuki, I think you're the lead on that.
That's me. Hannah and I had a discussion, but Hannah will speak.
Yeah, so the working party is Yuki and myself, and we've been sort of chatting ideas back and forth. One of the most prominent sort of feedback we get is information and how we are spreading information to the sailors and how they're receiving that and how we can make that more efficient and quicker. A lot of the feedback has been that things have been coming out quite late and not a lot of the sailors really know what's going on. So we've been sort of throwing some ideas around as to how we can make that happen, be that through social media, through the website, through potentially bringing back the old bulletin that we used to have. So that's what we're really focusing on, as well as obviously managing the social media side of things with the Mallory group, which has been really positive and really well received. A lot of sailors getting involved in that. And as that launched yesterday, that received a lot of coverage and the numbers were through the roof. And so that was really great to see from our point of view. And yeah, we're just going to continue working on keeping the information flowing from this committee to the sailors.
Great. Thank you, ladies, for your work on this. It's an always challenging situation we find ourselves in, getting enough information out to the sailors. Let's continue those discussions in committee on our monthly calls, and let's see what we can do to support those efforts more robustly. Let's move on to regional development, and that is Emma Halen chairing that.
Thank you, Betsy, and hi, everyone. It's my pleasure to give you a brief report, rather a status update of the work, or rather the plans for the Regional Development Working Party. That at this time consists of Jenny Davy, Abdel Karim Darush, Christian Frers, and myself, Emma Halen. And the ideas origins from the Para-World Sailing Strategic Plan. And we're looking at two major areas. First one would be appointing development hotspots and around them for networks. And the plan is to start by looking at the World Sailing approved training centers to see whether we can use the existing control documents and criteria as a starting point. And the idea would be for the hotspots to work as parasailing accelerators and coordinators in their area and act as regional development hubs so that we can get information and resources out through them. And the ideal would be for the networks of neighboring nations will be formed right around the hubs, and they make it possible to cooperate, share resources and experience and best practice and even equipment in the area. And they could also carry out common activities like training of sailors, coaches, volunteers, and also perform racing on suitable levels. The hotspots could also be of help, I see it, to World Sailing in communication matters, both spreading and gathering information. And we want to look at how we can make this complement and reinforce the outcomes of the well-established Paralympic or parasailing development program. And we're also looking at forming resources we understand that there is a demand for standards and guidelines and examples of best practice from nations starting up or developing their parasailing programs. So we're going to look into the possibilities of putting together a set of resources consisting of inspirational and informative materials that can be used by the training centers, networks, M&As, clubs, or programs aiming to include sailors of all abilities. And we hope that there will be a possibility to present this online on the new brilliant website as a growing resource, so it can be developed as we learn what kind of information is requested by the stakeholders. So any suggestions as what to include will be most welcome. And we will also need input from all of you on your special areas of interest and knowledge to make this happen. I was listening into the meeting of the Development of Regions Committee yesterday, and in true spirit of inclusion, I believe we should continue to develop all existing structures, documents, and initiatives by World Sailing in general, and of course, training and development resources and initiatives in particular, to raise parasailing awareness and reach an even higher level of inclusion of our sailors. That's it. If anyone has any questions, free.
That was a whole lot of information. Thank you, Emma. It seems that there's a lot going on there, and I agree with you. I was listening into the regions and development meeting yesterday, and there's a lot of parallel work being done, and I think a lot of collaboration can happen across the organization. So thank you and your team for that work. And I know Pinar expressed it in a chat to me yesterday that they are happy to work with us on, you know, moving some of these initiatives forward. So thank you for that. And we will continue this work in committee as well. Next on, we'll receive a report from the Inclusion Working Party, which is being led by David Staley. David?
Thanks, Betsy. And thank you also to yourself and Jenny and Jens, who have been helping with this one. We had a video conference recently just to try and get a start and try and outline what this working party would be focusing on, and it is a very broad topic, and the decision was that we need to focus on our role within the world sailing structure and upon diversifying disability types, the range of severity, along with increasing participation by women and youth. So there is a much broader interpretation or a broader scope of inclusion, and we would hope that's happening at a organisational level. And so we've identified initially four goals, and this is really only a draft at this stage. And subject to further input from the committee and the members of the working party, but essentially at an organisation level, just confirming that World Sailing's committed to an organisation-wide approach to inclusion and diversity, which we believe World Sailing is. Goal two is about identifying those areas that we would like to see greater diversity, and that's the diversity of types of disability and range of severity of para-athletes who are participating in the sport. Gender equity, of course, is something that we need to focus on, and youth. And all of that will need to be supported by a strategy for communication, build the awareness of the inclusive nature of parasailing through effective, whether it be social media, whatever forms of communication that will help make it a reality. So that, in summary, is my report, and I'd welcome any comments from other members of the working party or any questions. All good.
All good. Thanks, David. And we'll move right into the other working party that you lead, which would be the documents working party.
Okay, thank you. So this working party is a kind of is a bit ad hoc in that all of the little I sort of keep a tabs on the projects, but I really do rely on others to help out. And look, I might we'll just try and work down the list, the Parawild Sailing Strategic Plan. We'll have a look at that a little bit later in the meeting. It's due for review in 2023, so that we move to probably also 2024, and then we'll have 25 to 28 will be the next iteration. One of the more interesting recent developments is with the Parawild Sailing Race Management Manual. That had been updated a bit over 12 months ago, but had not been published. I believe that's probably because waiting for the website to all happen. But Håkon Andersen from the Race Officials Committee reached out and we talked about converting the Para World Sailing Race Management Manual into an appendix of the World Sailing Race Management Manual. Much has already been done with kiteboarding and offshore sailing, which is a much more inclusive format that parasailers are just included within the mainstream key documentation of world sailing. So the committee is very keen to proceed with that. Bernard Destrebet, who's of course all over the para classification documentation. Alfred Palenka and Heiko Kroger have offered to assist with this, and Håkon is going to be our link to the Race Officials Committee. So very happy about that project. It gives us another opportunity to refine the document and then work with race officials to hopefully get that completed sometime in the middle of next year. A couple of other documents we've actually decided to drop: the technical delegates guide and the race management policies, which Parawild Sailing had separately. We're looking at discontinuing them in favour of just using the World Sailing documents that are inclusive for all disciplines. And I'll just skip the para classification rules for the moment and come back to it at the end. Racing rules of sailing appendix CBS for blind match racing. That document is due for review in 2023, and we'll work with Racing Rules Committee on that one. And the notice of race and sailing instruction templates for blind fleet and match racing is something that we want to get underway in 2022, because we did have some work that was done, of course, on the racing rules in the past year. But so that's a project for next year. And the final one, which is a crucial document for parasailing, is the World Sailing Rules of Para Classification. This document's due for review in 2023, but may be amended from time to time. And Bernard Destrebet, of course, leads management of that documentation. So I'd invite Bernard, if you have any comments to add at this moment.
Thank you, David. No, at present, specific reason to modify the document. We had done a full review in 2018, and the document is very coherent and corresponds to what IPC requires at present. But IPC is looking into modifying
its documents in the next couple of years. So we're staying very aware of that. We'll try and be proactive in modifying our rules, our power classification as we approach the time when IPC changes its documents. We're lucky to have Jürgen Schwittei, who's a senior supplier, who is also part of the IPC classification committee. So we get quite a bit of information from him, which will allow us to stay up to date. Thank you, David. Over.
Fantastic. Thank you, Bernard. So, Betsy, that concludes my report. Happy to take any questions.
Thank you, David. That was pretty comprehensive in terms of what we've got going on. And I just wanted to note, it is really encouraging to see how since the Paraworld Sailing Committee has come into play within World Sailing after the merger with IFDS, how the organization has embraced parasailing and how a lot of our documentation is being merged into existing World Sailing documents. So it's more a more cohesive process and very much embraced by World Sailing as a whole. So thank you for your work and everyone who's contributing to these various documents. It really does make a difference, and you know, obviously that's showing with the participation of sailors and MNAs around the world. So thank you for your work on that. So that concludes the first part of item two, and I just wanted to move in and open for discussion, if there is any discussion within committee, the working relationships between our committee and other committees within World Sailing. And as I just mentioned in my last statement, it's very encouraging to see the collaboration, you know, with the race management group and blending our documentation in there, and the work that's being done by the regions and development committee, and looking at the inclusivity of sport and the growth and development of grassroots level sailing. And parasailing always comes up in these discussions. I think it's super important, and I would encourage all of us within our committee to work with committee members of other committees on these initiatives. I do want to open the floor to Heiko, who is our new athletes rep, our para rep on the Athletes Commission, to let us know what's been happening within the Athletes Commission and your perspective and your take on that since taking over for Jens Kroker. Heiko?
Yeah, I just started my work at the commission. So at the moment, I'm a bit more observer than active. So it's very interesting because you get lots of knowledge about what's going on at World Sailing. And especially in these days, we have nearly every day a small meeting with all the information we get from the meetings and committees. And so it's interesting work, and I'm quite happy to be one of them. And I hope to get more input in the next months. So take some time to slip in this team. And but what I can say is there are lots of great guys working very close together with the athletes and also World Sailing. And it's good to have this commission. And I think if we have problems, questions or whatever, we can easily forward them to the committee, and we get response as soon as possible, and we will discuss things there if needed. So I would like to invite everybody to join or to forward me information or questions, whatever. I can forward them into the commission, and we might find solution answers, whatever.
Great, thank you for that. I know I put you in the hot spot, and you've only been on the commission for a short period of time, but I think it's super encouraging that the parasailers have representation within that very active and robust commission, and it's been very nice to see how that group has embraced parasailing as a whole. So thank you for the work that you're doing there. And again, thank you to Jens Croker, who is our outgoing member of that committee. And we hope, Heiko, that you will be an active party of our committee and working parties as Jens has in the past. So thank you for joining us on that. To Para World Sailing Committee members, is there anything you would like to add or comment on your working relationship with other World Sailing Committees at this time?
Nothing other than it's fantastic, Betsy. I echo your sentiments. I think the level of cooperation with the other committees is fantastic.
Thanks, David. Well, let's move on to item 3 in the agenda. We are going to receive a report from Massimo on the IPC relationship. Massimo?
Before item 3, we're David Graham, so World Sailing CEO, just joined the call. So I leave the floor to him.
That's kind of Massimo. I don't really need to say anything. I think I'm sorry I was late. Our board meeting overran a little bit, and I just wanted to show my appreciation to you, Betsy, and the entire committee. And I think, and I share David's view, that it's really encouraging that it seems that all the committees and commissions are getting together. I think when we've got an issue like, you know, out of the Olympics, it's really nice to see our whole community pulling together and making sure that we do what we can to increase participation and address all of those issues that we know why we came out in the first place, that the IPC have mentioned to us. So you've got the I don't know if Marcus spoke, and I see that Marcus is here when I didn't arrive on time, but the board are fully behind it, and the committees and the committees and commissions are behind you. And we'll do what we can from the office. We'll give Massimo all the support we can. And I just wanted to say thank you very much, everybody, for all of your efforts. And it seems you've got full support from the world sailing community around the globe. I don't need to take any more time.
Thank you, David, for those comments. And I must say that it has been so encouraging, the support from the executive office of World Sailing, your support, the team at World Sailing, staff and the board has made this process of the bid for re-inclusion so much easier because of the sport and the ongoing activities. So thank you for a job well done. You've come in a difficult time, and it's so encouraging to see us all moving forward with everything that has been discussed at past council meetings and in our internal meetings. So thank you for your support on that. Okay, Massimo, on to you. How about a report on the IPC relationship?
Yes, in the last year, we maintained a constant contact with the IPC. We had some discussion. I had some call with Jürgen, who's the International Federation Relationship Manager, and asking about to keep us updated about all the process and what's going on to IPC. IPC is as all the federation and all the IF in a constant process of changing, especially close to the Olympic Games and after the Paralympic Games. And David had a meeting with Mike Peters, who's the IPC CEO, to discuss about world sailing and what we are doing for parasailing. there has been some contact between the World Sailing President and the IPC President, and we have been invited as with an observer to the IPC AGM that will be in December in Taipei. 99% Kan Hai Lee, the World Sailing President, will be at the event, and you will discuss. It will be a good, great occasion for us to get in touch with IPC in person for the first time after 2 years. And it's even more important because the IPC AGM will be the election of the new IPC board and the IPC president. There is only one candidate for the IPC president, so Andrew Parsons will remain president, but there are some good names in the board, so it will be great for our president to get in touch directly with the IPC and discuss a lot of matters in person. For the IPC, we are still waiting an exact deadline for the LA 2028 application process. IPC appointed in June 2021 a new Paralympic Games manager, director, and is a woman called Colleen Well. And we know that she's working, she's taking care and analyzing all the criteria of application. She will prepare a document that we share. She will share with IPC board, and then the criteria will be sent out. I had my last communication a couple of days ago, so we had no idea of the timeline so far, but we are waiting, and we know that IPC is working on that. Other than IPC, I think we had a good relationship with the Asian Paralympic Committee. We had a couple of meetings with them, and we have a good relationship so far with the European Paralympic Committee. The European Paralympic Committee invited World Sailing at the European Paralympic Committee meeting. It will be the first week of November in Cyprus, and I'll be joining that meeting. It's important for us to keep in contact with all the regional association, because it's important for our sailor having the opportunity to sail in regional games and regional association manage regional games. So that's my report about the relationship with IPC and the regional Paralympic committees.
Massimo, may I ask you a question as follow-up to that? Recently at the HANSA World Championship, I believe that an IPC board member was at that event. Can you give us a little feedback on that?
No, unfortunately, there was a plan to have Luca Pancalli, one of the VP, but he had a sudden commitment, so he sent his apologies and he wasn't at the event. But the Italian Paralympic Committee, and Luca is also a member of, is still the president of the Italian Paralympic Committee, was one of the supporters of the event. So they were patronizing the event. So he knew everything, and he sent a message that he was very happy to support an event, because it was a great event for any standard in a COVID time.
Thanks for that. I think that is something that we need to keep in mind as we have events being hosted, world championships on the calendar during the 2022 season. We want to encourage attendance by and participation by IPC vice presidents or board members. So thank you for that report. I know we have as 3C on the agenda to report on the Mallory Group initiatives. You had mentioned they're gonna jump in a little bit later to give us an update on what they've been doing, is that correct?
Yes, Mallory Group will join at around 3 o'clock, so in 1 hour.
Okay, so we will jump over that item on the agenda. Does anybody else on the committee have any comments or thoughts on item number 3, International Paralympic Committee and the Games, before we move on to our strategic plan in item 4? All right, so we will jump past 3C and come back to it in an hour's time. So let's move on to item 4 of the agenda, which is our Paraworld Sailing Strategic Plan that runs through 2023. And Massimo, do you have a presentation on this?
Yes, I will share my presentation now.
Thank you.
Can you confirm you see the presentation?
Yes, it's showing on the screen.
Yes, perfect. So this is a Paraworld Sailing report. The report I prepared is basically compared to the 4 main areas that we have in the Paraworld Sailing strategy plan, and we presented in 2019. The 4 main goals are to increase participation worldwide. So we have 45 countries by 2023, and we have 50 countries by end of 2025. The second main goal is to expand the competition and find an effective way to create more opportunity for our sailors to compete. Then we have a part about effective marketing and communication, and I think that's really important based also on the communication working party report. And we have governance and rules. The first part, I remember from the strategic priorities, are to support World Sailing M&As, educate M&A personnel, and encourage the creation of inclusive and parasailing program. The second priority is to increase diversity. We want to broaden in our strategic plan the range of physical disabilities, and including also sensory intellectual that has been not really involved in the last few years. We want to grow participation with a goal of 20% athletes below the age of 30 and 30% of women. And we want to work on equipment. As Alfred highlighted in this report, we are still working. We have an equipment, but it's still a working process because we want to go towards an equipment that is available, affordable, transportable, and well suited for inclusive parasailing programs. So my next is what we did so far in 2021 up to 2021. So with the PDP since 2017, we supported 39 unique countries and more than 212 unique sailors, with the participation of 17 new countries. When I mean new countries, when I tell new countries, I mean countries that has never been involved before. We have seen in the previous year, we have been involved in Samoa, Cook Island, some Pacific Island, we had Estonia, Latvia, and several other countries. This year in Palermo, we had for the first time, we had Lithuania, we had Oman, and we had Malta involved in parasailing. So it's a constant expansion. Some of these countries of the PDP, they don't have yet a parasailing program. So they send some coaches or they send some sailors, but they haven't been involved officially in some of our events. And then another important part is the adaptive sailing manual that has been prepared by US Sailing, has been downloaded by more than 50 countries. Just in the last year, we had a lot of participation, download and participation in this manual. The second point is we are continuing to work with physical disabilities and blind sailing organizing event. And we finalized the first intellectual disability event dedicated with Virtus in in November 2022 in Australia. There will be a report after explaining all the events, but this is very important because this will be part of the Virtus Regional Games that are held in Australia, and they will have the full support of the Australian Sailing, and David Stanley will be will be even more involved in the event. And for the first year, this year in 2021, we had the Parasailing Championship, including the Class World Championship, and this showed the full inclusivity of sailing and parasailing event. We had the Hansa Award, Hansa Para Award involving the Hansa Award in Palermo, and there's been a huge event. We had the RS Venture Connect Para Award involving the RS Venture Award in Travemünde in July. And unfortunately, we weren't able to have the 2.4 award, including the World Championship, because the World Championship of the 2.4 was planned to be in August in Norway, but has been cancelled. But we managed, with the help of the German Federation and with the help of the German National Paralympic Committee and the 2.4 class, to have a 2.4 OD event part of the Warnemünde, Woche, and part of the World Cup. In increasing participation, an important area is how many classified sailors we have. As today, we have more than 730 sailors classified on all six continents. But some of this area and continents are not yet widely and regularly practicing parasailing. It's easy now, as Bernard told before, we have a new system, a new database, so it will be, it's really easy for now us to extract the data and to manage classification and to understand where we need to aim and we need to increase our focus. Second is expand the competition. Was reaching the target of 45 nations, having Parallel Sailing in conjunction with World Championship, maintain a program of ranking, and permit exhibition events. In 2021, as I told, we have Para Awards, and counting only the Para events, we had participation from 29 countries and 120 sailors. This is a small number compared to 2019 and 2018, when we had around 40, but in a age, in a year when there was still impact of COVID, during all the year, there were a lot of travel restrictions that impacted a lot of our countries, especially in Asia, is a good number. 29 countries coming from all six continents is a massive participation. For the next year, we will continue the inclusion of Para Awards in Class World Championship. There is already a calendar for 2022. And next year, we have the opportunity to have par events in the World Cup, in some of the regional games, and there will be the Master Games in 2022. Ranking list, as Alfred told, and thanks so much to the Alfred work, has been constantly updated and has been posted online. All the ranking calculation, all the ranking data has been done on an Excel by Alfred. Hopefully with the new website, the ranking management will be easier and updating the ranking will be quicker. And we will continue to have World Championship for different types of disabilities. As I told before, we will introduce for the first time an Intellectual Disability World Championship. We are in discussion with blind sailing for the blind sailing events. Blind sailing president just resigned months ago. Now there is a new management, and there is a discussion about what we can do in 2022 for to be able to have a blind sailing event. We are not sure yet if it will be a blind fleet race or a blind match race, but everyone wants to have an event, so we are working with them. And we will continue with the fully inclusive format like we had in Hamburg. And we have this new format that is called the Inclusive World Championship. Effective marketing and communication, we want to grow media traction. We want to increase global awareness, and we want to feature excellence by parasailers, and including even new sport, new equipment. What we did so far, we worked with the World Sailing Media team to prepare video and highlights about parasailing event, has been posted on social media and our website, especially in the last period, because all our event has been, July, September, October. There's been a lot of posts for the RS Venture event, the 2.4 event, and the class event. Increase global awareness through mainstream, electronic, and social media. We appointed the Mallory Group to help us with the IPC application, but the Mallory Group project will go beyond the IPC application. And as have you seen in the last 2 days after yesterday, we want to increase and show parasailing and increase knowledge in mainstream media and newspaper. Mallory Group will give you more data, but basically yesterday, all the after our release has been covered by the BBC, by a lot of media all around the world. We were pinned as on the front page of Reuters. So we want to continue this mainstream media targeting. And then the last part is a series of web courses for classifier and parallels management are in preparation to attract new classifiers and increase knowledge of parasailing in the race official area. This year, there was a plan to have a classification meeting and a classification opportunity in Oman. I think that will not happen in Oman, but we are still working with the other area of the World Sailing Office. They are already using interactive educational program to work to use this interactive program for parallel sailing. Governance strategic priorities were to populate resources on the World Sailing web pages, to review the parallel sailing management manual, and to maintain key documentation in the supplement of the World Sailing rules and regulations. What we did so far, basically we uploaded and we keep updated all the World Sailing website web pages on the Parallel Sailing Committee. TAD guidelines have been amended last year to include accessibility of the venues. So each TD needs to understand if the venue is accessible. This is for the aim of a full inclusion. We want to have a full events, and we want to give everyone the same opportunity to race at the event. The parallel sailing race management manual, as David told, has been worked out and will be part of the World Sailing Race Management Manual. This is an absolute step forward in a view of full inclusivity, because we don't want to maintain two different manuals where we have the same sport, the same rules, the same club, so it's easy. And a draft has been submitted to the Race Management Subcommittee, and with the ideal deadline for approval by mid-2022. All other para-related documents are updated. World Sailing is, as I told before, in constant communication with the IPC and other regional sailing and Paralympic committee, like ASAF Asian Asian Sailing Federation. Just appointing the Paralympic personnel that will follow all the Paralympic classes. And we will continue to maintain our position. We are now one of the, probably the only observer in APSO, that is the Association of Paralympic Sport Organization, that is, that we are not in the Paralympic Games, and we are a member of Virtus. We are working with them for the Intellectual Disability World Championship. We started a discussion with Special Olympics. We have been approached by Special Olympics in the last months because they wanted to do something with sailing. They recognized the full inclusivity of sailing and what sailing can do for people with different sort of intellectual disabilities. So we are in discussion with them to have an MOU. I think this concludes my presentation. If anyone has any question.
That was a very comprehensive overlook of our strategic plan and the updates, Massimo. Thank you for that. David, you have comments?
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, Betsy. And thanks, Massimo. I think that was a great sort of summary of how we've gone with the strategic plan. And I think we can be pretty satisfied in terms of that progress that we've made. Just in terms of the one other athlete group that I think we probably will be needing to move on next year to do some work on is deaf sailing. They're planning on having a deaf sailing championship in Poland again next year. Will be sanctioned currently by ICSD. Which is the peak international sporting body for people who are deaf or hard of hearing. I just think we need to look at how we can work to support that athlete group and forge a relationship with the other peak bodies.
Thank you for those comments, David. I just wanted to touch on a couple of points that Massimo made. It is encouraging that we had so much participation by MNAs in the past year, especially with travel restrictions from COVID. However, those numbers are still below what IPC wants to see from 32 nations. The one point I did want to make is it's exceedingly important that MNAs submit data on local, national, and regional events to the World Sailing Office because those numbers do count towards participation. So if your MNA, your nation, your area, your region is hosting an event, please get that data into us. I know there's been a lot of collaboration within the Scandinavian Nordic region for participation for clinics and small events. It would be great if we can see that happening in Asia, in South America, North America. We do it already. It's happening in Europe. So participation numbers are critical, but we can only track that data if it's submitted to World Sailing. The other point that I wanted to raise was, we all know that in these times, finances, funding is very limited within MNAs, especially because parasailing is not in the Paralympic Games. There's not a lot of National Paralympic Committee support for parasailing. So whether it's an emerging nation or a developed nation, funding is very limited. And I think all of us need to collaborate and work together with our national governing bodies to support participation by parasailing, even if it's in a limited capacity, because as Massimo noted, participation at world championships, at regional events, our numbers that are critical. So even though funding may be short, let's see what we can do collectively together to make participation happen, especially in the next couple of years while we are submitting this bid for re-inclusion. So I'll open to the floor, other committee members, any thoughts or comments on our strategic plan contributions in terms that you would like to make to this discussion? Bernard?
Bernard here. Yes, thank you for giving me the floor. Just to add on a couple of statistics, rather encouraging that we can get out of our database. Originally in our database, we have 59 fruit. That includes all satyrs classified since 2007. If we just include satyrs being classified since 2012, we're still at 56 countries. In 2016, since 2016, we've had 49 countries participate. And if we only take people in the last 3 years, we still have 38 countries that have been classified since 2018. And amongst those people classified since 2018, that's 208 satyrs that have been classified, which is, in my opinion, rather a significant amount of satyrs that are still playing the game presently. Thank you.
Thanks for that data, Bernard. That's really encouraging. Other thoughts and comments by committee members? Oh, somebody just had their hand up and it went away on my screen. Does anyone want to speak to this?
Yes, go ahead. Betsy. May I take the floor?
Yes, please.
Okay, so I just want to stress out in this setting that is so crucial that we have a proper ranking for when everybody in Africa, in Oceania, in South America, wherever in Europe has a goal, see whether to climb up in the ranking, so to proceed to a higher rank position. I think then it's as well a good tool to ask the MNAs, to ask the competition management to provide the results to World Sailing. I think this is one of the things why I'm that much after the rankings, because I think this is really a good chance for us. I just wanted to stress it out once more in this round. Thank you.
Thank you, Alfred. That is a key element to the success of our program and our a bid for re-inclusion, is getting those sailors on the ranking list and getting points assigned to them. So yes, data acquisition and results is really crucial. Anyone else? Anyone else have thoughts and comments on our strategic plan and the work that has been being done moving forward? All right. Well, thank you for that report, Massimo. We can jump to item 5 on our agenda, which is events. And I know you have a presentation on this as well.
Yes. Give me a second. Can you see the event report?
Yes, we can.
Okay, perfect. Okay, so for 2021, we had 4 main events planned. They were the Powerball Championship for the 2.4 meter OD, the Powerball Championship for the Hansa class, the Powerball Championship for the RS Venture, and the Inclusive World Championship. The first event we had was that the RS Venture Connect World Championship in Warnemünde. It took place from the 24th to the 27th of July 2021. The event featured the participation of 4 boats in the para category. There were 2 Italian boats and 2 Swiss boats, and 11 boats in the open category. Some of the boats in the open category, they had a para sailor from board, but they were not eligible for para because the other member was not a para sailor. For the classified participants, we had 4 male and no female. We had a classification at the event managed by Pedro and Jürgen. At the event, when the event started, we had some logistical issue that has been reported, like there was lack of toilet and it was very poor accessibility to the pontoons. But some of these issues, they were due to some construction work that were going forward the event. And after the first couple of days, some of this issue has been resolved. So this, I think, is a part that we need to work with all the classes when we have events to have a more detailed report of pontoons and accessibility. It's not only for the adventure, but for all the classes, and you will see other classes. The 2.4D World Championship took place in Warnemünde in Germany, that is close to Rostock, from 25 to 29 September 2021. We had 16 boats in the para category, participation in the para from Germany, Italy, Sweden, Czech Republic, Finland, Russia, and Spain, and 32 boats in the open category. So we had 50% of the participants, they were para. We had 2 female participants and 14 male in the classified, but we had 1 female in the first 3 classified, and 2 females in the first 5. So there was a small participation of female, but the impact on the results and the rank list was very important. Measurement was performed by 2 international measurers, Keith Gordon and Matti Muniovara. Matti is in IM in the 505 class, that wanted to become IM in the 2.4 class. So it's really important having a new IM for the 2.4. Also here in the logistical side, there was a problem with parking. The parking was far away, but has been promptly resolved by organizer. Bernard was a classifier with Jürgen there, and he worked with the organizer to solve this issue. The Hansa Para World Sailing Championship took place in Palermo from 5 to 9 October. The event featured the participation of 66 boats in the para category and 85 boats in the open category. For the para, we didn't count the doubles because it's not a para category, but they included the para, there were 146 boats at the event. So it was really a big event in terms of management and logistics. Participants from 20 counties. We had from Italy, Spain, Turkey, France, Netherlands, Oman for the first time, Poland, Great Britain, Australia, Germany, Netherlands, Portugal. We have China, was the first time since 2017. We had a Chinese sailor. We had Turkey, and Estonia, Greece, we have Malta for the first time, we have Chile, Brazil, USA, Lithuania, and Czech Republic. These 2 countries, they were for the first time involved in the Hansa event, and Namibia. Namibia was involved last time in 2017, and some of these countries have been part of the PDP, so has been supported by World Sailing. And we have more details in the PDP report. There were 2 classifiers at the event, Bernard and Pedro. They did a great job because they were expecting only a few sailors to classify, and at the end they classified more than 50 sailors. There were John Figures as international measure for the Hansa class, and there were a number of national measurer there to help. Even here, when we started the PDP, when we arrived, there was some problem in the infrastructure. There was some delays, but it has been solved. So I think we need to work hard with the organizer to make sure that the venue are accessible and all the infrastructure were in place. Palermo was, as I told, quite a challenging event because even in the best expectation when the organizers started the event, they were expecting around 90 sailors and around 90 bota, and they ended up with, as I told, more than 100 and I think 189 sailors competing, 146 boats, and they had to put in place a huge Paralympic village that was fully accessible, and so every sailor at the end was very happy with this event, but also with all the events, with the 2.4 and the RS20. This is a data that David made some work on the numbers and showed the number of classified and female athletes at our event. We had in the Hansa 303 one person, 69 athletes, 52 of these were classified and 17 not classified. So the percentage of classified is about 75%. We had, as expected, a very low percentage of classified sailors in the Hansa two person, because it's not a para class. So we had 12%. And for the first time this year, we awarded a world championship for the Hansa Liberty. Hansa Liberty, we saw the event, we know it is about the cutters, especially high disabilities. So we had from 16 Hansa, we had 13 classified athletes and just three not classified. So the percentage was 81%. I must tell that from these 13 classified athletes, seven, so more than 50%, they were using the servo system. So they were using the boat only with the sip and puff or some sort of joystick. And this is really important to show how we can really, with the right boat, reach high disability and allow everyone to be involved. On the number of athletes, we saw that in the Hansa 303 one person, we had 69 male, 69 athletes, 14 female and 55 male. So we are more or less in the range of having around 20-30%. In the Hansa two person, it was impossible to calculate because some of the boats were mixed. And so it was very hard to have this data. And this is another great, benefit of the Hansa Liberty. We have 16 athletes, 9 female and 7 male. So for the first time, I think we had more female than male, 50%. And it's really important in the Hansa servo. So all the podium, they were female. And also in the Hansa open category, so not servo, the first, I think we had two female in the first three, and the overall winner of the Hansa Liberty category, so including servo and non-servo, was Vera, that was sailing using a servo boat. So this showed that it was a great and full inclusive event, the Hansa Para Oceanic Championship and the Hansa World Championship. The last event is the Inclusive World Championship. We started with this event in 2020, and for the second time, the event was in Hamburg, end of August. We had participation of 18 boats, in the inclusive configuration is one able and one parasailor. We had 7 countries at the event, so Germany, Poland, Sweden, Austria, Estonia, Netherlands, and GBR, and we had one classifier at the event. For the future, we have events planned to include the Para World Sailing Championship. We still have the 2.4 World Championship in the US in November, to be the first week of November. I'm still waiting to be 5 to 11, but I'm still waiting confirmation. We have an RS Venture World Championship in Oman, should be October 2022. We have an ANSA Continental Championship, because in 2020, ANSA is doing its one world championship, one regional championship every other year. So that will be in May 2022 in Europe, and in other countries will be decided. And we will have, as I told in the events and in the general Paralympic strategy, the Intellectual Disabilities Paralympic Championship from the 8th to 11th November 2022 in Australia. We saw the benefit of having an included Paralympic Sailing Award. The event will remain in the media and in all the press, the Open 2.4, the Open Hansa, and the focus will be on an inclusive event. The inclusion of a World Sailing Para Award will help the coverage of media and social network. We will help providing a technical delegate in order to help with organization, document World Sailing rules, and we will provide a team of international classifiers in order to perform functional classification. In our event, international classifier, they have been beyond being on international classifier. In all the events, they helped and they helped the organizer on the area that are like accessibilities. So it's very important having world sailing personnel at this event. We have other events planned. We have the Inclusive European Championship for sailing in Germany in May. It will be hosted by a number of clubs, because you will be included in a week of increased awareness of parasailing with meetings and round tables about parasailing. We will have continental events including parasailing. We have the EuroSAF, and I just been notified that there will be EuroSAF Para-European in Sweden. I don't know yet the dates, so maybe Emma can have more info for us. And we will have the World Master Games in Kansai. The World Master Games, they were planned for 2021. They has been postponed to 2022, but there is still a discussion if they will be postponed for another year, because we know there's still a lot of travel restriction to Japan. And a final decision will be taken by the organizing authority by the 5th of November. And then the main event in our calendar will be the Sailing World Championship 2023 in The Hague. We will have in 2022 some test event in early August. The dates of this test event has been sent to the classes. And as soon as we have these dates finalized, we will work with the classes and the organizers to understand how we can work this test event. That concludes my presentation. If there are some questions.
Great report, Massimo. A lot of events that have happened and a lot in the works. And again, the data that is starting to become more public in terms of participation and the female participation at these championships is super encouraging. And I just wanted to reiterate, at the 2.4 meter one design, the technical para championship in Bornemünde, Germany, it was very interesting because although it was an open event with quite a number of sailors at it, it was impressive to see that three of the top four podium finishes in the open event were parasailors. And I think that's important to note because all along, sailing, especially in the 2.4 meter class, in the former Paralympic class, the sonar, those classes, including the Hansa classes, have always been inclusive, open, encouraging sailors with disabilities to be practicing and sailing against able-bodied sailors. And we in sailing know that this is nothing new, and it was something that had not been really recognized and celebrated by the International Paralympic Committee. And now that the IPC has put forward their campaign of We Are the 15, recognizing that 15% of the world's population has a disability, and their push to make sport and society more inclusive for the 15% of the world population. World Sailing has really done and been supportive of inclusivity for some period of time. And I think we, in our collective campaigns for re-inclusion for 2028, need to emphasize that point, that sailing has been inclusive in the past. It continues to be inclusive in terms of participation. And as we move forward with these events, it's going to be really important to address the inclusion and participation and growth and development in the areas of female participation and youth participation. So, kudos to what we've been doing so far. The work has begun, it is ongoing, and we need to keep, the gas pedal down to the floor to ensure that M&As around the world are pushing forward the inclusivity and participation of sailors, able-bodied and disabled. So thank you for that report. Committee members, does anyone have thoughts, comments in terms of the events and what may be upcoming?
Betsy, do we think we just want a bit of an update on the Parawhale Sailing Championships for athletes with intellectual disability?
Sure, absolutely. Please, David.
Yeah, so at this stage, it's all looking fairly firmed up. Dates are 5th to the 12th of November 2022. This event is sanctioned by World Sailing, but would be held in conjunction or at the same time as the Virtus Oceania and Asian Games, so a multi-sport event, and it would enable athletes who participate in the championship to also have that games experience of an opening and closing ceremony, and also gives us the opportunity to link in with all of the national affiliates of Virtus, who are the peak international sporting body for people with intellectual impairment. So at this stage, the plan is that it'll be conducted in three basic divisions, I suppose. The Hansa 303 is the basic equipment that we'd be using. Single person competition for people who are on the Virtus master list under their two categories, II1 and II2. We're not including II3, which is the athletes who are with high functioning autism. But Virtus are supportive and have directed us that way. So that the single person would also be divided into male and female competition, although we wouldn't have quota numbers that they're required to achieve. Then a two-person competition, again using the HANSA 303, where both athletes are classified under the Virtus, are on the Virtus master list. And the third would be a development division, if you like. So two-person, and only one of the sailors needs to be on the Virtus master list. So people with fairly high level of intellectual disability would be able to sail with a person who doesn't have an intellectual disability, and it would not be a world championship, it would be just rated as an international championship, but it would be very much seen as a development opportunity to grow participation in this. So Southport Yacht Club on the Gold Coast in Queensland is the host venue. Quite close, there'll be other sports happening on the Gold Coast, and it's about an hour's drive from Brisbane, which will be the centre of those games. So we're just now working with Virtus to develop a communication strategy to get information to all of their affiliates, and we'll be able to also go out through class associations and organisations such as Sailability. And so at this stage, we have a draft notice of race, but we've got a little bit of work to do over the next month or so to get that finalised. Thanks, Betsy.
Thank you for that report, David. I have one quick follow-up question, and then Yuki has her hand up as well. So on Virtus has a very specific rating system that they use. Some MNAs are not familiar with Virtus and how athletes would be classified. I know in the US we have a lot of Special Olympians, but no Virtus. Will there be a way that we can do a cheat sheet, a Q&A on how MNAs can have their sailors classified to participate in this championship, since it is a step forward in inclusivity, and I think many may be interested but don't know the process by which athletes would be able to get classified in this system?
Yes, certainly that's seen as one of the key steps that we need to take. There is some good information on the Virtus website around athlete eligibility. They don't use classification is not kind of a term that they use, so they talk about eligibility. And so it's a matter of there's a national classifiers as are in many countries, but there may be countries that we could get involved in this who don't actually have that national affiliate. So we've got to make sure that we can provide the opportunity for those people to get registered and achieve eligibility and make it as straightforward as possible. But look, one of the reasons why, you know, we've aligned with Virtus in particular is that they're one of the founding members of the National Paralympic Committee. Their eligibility and classification system is recognised by the IPC, and we're able to then plug into that without having to develop all of that expertise ourselves. So, but I think you're quite right. The biggest challenge with this is the communication and being able to get that information out to all of to the MNAs and also to the Virtus affiliates, because I think we've got already, particularly through organisations like Special Olympics and Sailability, there's a big group of sailors out there with intellectual disability. It's a matter of making it easy to understand how they can achieve eligibility and get involved in the event.
Thanks for that. We have some time to be able to get that information out. I just think it's important that we put it in such a format to make it understandable and easily actionable. Yep. And Massimo, quick follow-up with you on the Virtus thing. Some months ago, there was talk about having an e-sailing event for sailors with intellectual disability in conjunction with Virtus. Is that a dead issue now, or is that something that will be revived?
It's something that we are still working on. The woman that was following with us, Emma, for then left Virtus, so we had to restart, and then we had some other issue. But it's something that I think we could do in conjunction with the event next year in Australia, and it's something that is still going on and is still in discussion.
Thank you for that. Yuki, you've had your hand up for a while. Please, floor is yours.
Thank you. From me, just an update for the event about the World Masters in Kansai that Massimo just mentioned in the presentation. We just had information last night in Japan time that the Japan's organizing committee will propose to postpone it to 2026 to IMGA. So it's most likely to be 26. And let me add the comment to what David said. I'm feeling that for many Asian countries, we need more communication, including the classification issue. So it's really I think crucial topics that we need to start working on. Thank you.
Thanks, Yuki. Alfred?
No, sorry, I was misleading you, sorry.
Okay, thanks. Anyone else have any comments, thoughts on event schedules, some of the any challenges or upcoming events that we may have missed?
There was Hannah.
Sorry, thank you. I just had a question. There seems to be a bit of a common theme about infrastructure issues, and I know we never had that as a problem in the past, really. You know, we had the odd bit of feedback here and there. Are we looking into that, first question, and then secondly, are we going to look at maybe doing the surveys that we used to do at events so we can further improve these events going forward? Because we used to have a really extensive survey system, I know, after events that we would do.
Yes, for the question, it's something that we will look at. This year has been quite a special year because some event we had like 2 months knowing where the event was going on, and there was some restriction about sending a TD, but it's something that for the next event will be, now we have a more longer plan, something will be done. If a TD is not there, there will be an international classifier acting as checking about accessibility and logistics. So we have something in plan for that. And about the survey, it's something that we can do. We still have all the survey we sent out after the Para World Sailing Championship, and we have the data of the registered sailor, so it's something that can be easily done.
Great, thank you for those comments. Alfred, you have your hand up again? Okay, it keeps going up. Anyone else have any thoughts or comments that they would like to make on this topic? Bernard?
Thank you, Betsy. In the database, we now have the email addresses of almost all of our centers in classified. Perhaps we consider using that as a communication tool for future events and addressing communication issues.
Very good point. The more accurate our data is, the better the communications will be. We can take that on as in our next committee meeting in terms of exploring more and better, more frequent communications. Any other thoughts on this topic before we move on? Great discussion, and I am sure we will be discussing future events as they come on the calendar. Let's move on to the PDPs, our Paralympic Development Program. Massimo is going to give us a report regarding the events for 2021 and what is on the calendar being planned for 2022. Massimo?
Yes. So this is the PDP report for 2021. We, after a year that everything was basically shut up in 2020, we thought that we need to focus, as we did before, on the opportunities. We saw that we have some of the areas in the world, like you see Africa, Asia, some part of Eastern Europe and Central America that have no participation in sailing, no coverage, no parasailing program. So with our PDP, when we started to discuss the PDP in 2021, we were focusing on this area. In 2021, we had four PDP planned. There was a PDP planned for 2021 for USA, just before the Claggett Regatta. It was originally planned to cover the Caribbean and Central America area. It was in June 2021. Then the event has been postponed to August 2021, but due to some travel restriction and closed border in the US, it was impossible to run this PDP. Same for the Singapore. We were having this event in Singapore that was supported by MetaZone and the Singapore Sailing Association. We decided to have we started with the big event, a regional event. We downgraded a bit the event to be a national event. But then the event was planned in July, and there was a third wave of COVID in Singapore. So the border has been shut. It was impossible to run this PDP. There was the PDP in Italy that you will see is the only PDP we run this year. And there was a plan to have a PDP in Oman in early November. Unfortunately, in the first week of October, a cyclone hit Musana, so the sailing center of Oman, and basically severely damaged three of their adventures that they had there. And so there were no other boats available to have an event. They still have two boats. But it was very hard having a PDP only with two boats. So that will be postponed for the next year. PDP in Palermo. PDP in Palermo is the only PDP we had this year. When we send the invitation in August, in July, we had 13 officially registered participants. We had 9 sailors and 4 coaches. Officially registered at the event, they were coming, the PDP, they were coming from Ireland, Chile, Czech Republic, Lithuania, Namibia, Estonia, Philippines, and Brazil. Unluckily, Philippines has been, they had no visa to travel to Italy, and then there was still a travel problem with COVID, so they weren't able to be at our event. As always happened at all the PDP, we have a number of officially participants that are registered and a greater number of unofficially participants. So when we started the PDP, we had a lot of other sailors, they were there and they will join our event. We had sailors and coaches from Greece, we had from GBR and from Oman, that was competing at the parasailing event for the first time, bringing our number to of attendees to 27 with several other coaches attending. Part of this PDP, I want to thank Rob Holden, that was in Palermo running the PDP and helping all the PDP sailors also during the event. And as part of the PDP, there was a part reserved to Bernard that for the first time we explained a part about classification. So what is classification, who can be classified, and a part about anti-doping. We know that some of our sailors take some medication. Some of these medications can be in the list of banned substances for anti-doping. So Bernard was there to make like a brief explanation of the anti-doping procedures and the WADA regulation. I think a special mention for the PDP, go to Greece. Greece Sailing Federation sent 10 coaches to the PDP because these 10 coaches are part of a long-term project to promote national awareness of parasailing in Greece. They were coming from 10 different clubs all around Greece, and they attended the PDP. They attended the first day of the event, and now they are back in Greece and they are ready to start their mission to promote parasailing. And that has been important for an MNA. Was really great having an MNA sending coaches and supporting coaches at the PDP. These are the number of the PDP since 2017. We had, as I told before, 212 participants. These are unique participants. We had sailors that competed more than one, that participated more than once. We had 39 countries in total, from 6 continents and 17 new countries since 2017. What we have for 2022 and some other long-term projects. We have Oman, that is part of the long-term program to have a PDP. And they want to have a PDP, a constant PDP. We have Hong Kong in March 2022. We have US. We hope to have the PDP before the Claggett Regatta. That should be in June 2022. It's probably the second year that we postponed. We have Singapore in July 2022. Also, Singapore is part of a long-term plan for a PDP for like the next 5 years. And then hopefully we have South Africa. In the last, I think we are discussing PDP in South Africa since probably 2018-19. We had some issue with lack of boats and then COVID and the travel restriction. We have now in South Africa a good fleet of boats. We have a couple of Skeleton. We have some SV14. We have some Hansa. So we are ready to have a PDP by the end of 2022. About PDP, I want, I think there is Rob Holden in the call. So I want to pass the floor to Rob. Rob and Kat has been really instrumental to help us to run all this PDP and to support, and the support by the training and regional department has been absolutely amazing. So I leave the floor to Rob.
Thank you very much, Massimo. Thank you, Betsy, and your team. Just a few words on the PDP in Palermo. It again was an absolute privilege to be involved with the PDP. It's a whole different experience, yet I'm trying to bring the two worlds of coaching people with disabilities and other people together, because there's not that much difference. And it was interesting for me in the Hansa class that a lot of the people firstly are not taught the basics, so there's a huge gap in the coaching of the Hansa at the base level of teaching how to race. I think people are put into the boats and allowed to sail socially and recreationally and never directed into the basics of racing. I'm not even talking more intricate sail trim and that sort of thing, but rules, there's a huge lack of knowledge of rules, and there's some people who take advantage of that. And so that stood out for me with this particular event and clinic. And I am going to take it on us to make sure that when we're working with coaches who are working with people with disabilities, that we are making sure that they are coaching the people not to just get around the course or just be pushed off. I want them to take it more seriously about these people could go to a world championship and compete in the world championship. So that was one of the things that stood out for me, and I think is sort of a watershed in discussion with coaches, that we need to be more serious about what we're doing with the Hansa class in when we're looking at racing. The group that was on the PDP was amazing and really sucking up a lot of the knowledge. It is a difficult thing because you've got people who have sailed a lot and are quite experienced, and other people who are almost brand new in the boat. So it's again different in that because of the type of boat, we find that some people who are just starting to sail will go to a world championship, and which, whether it's right or wrong, I don't know. I think it's a good thing at this stage. And so it's taking some people just to get around the course and other people to get them around the course a lot faster. So again, great experience, and thank you for giving me that experience. And I hope we can continue doing development with this situation. Thank you.
Hi, Rob. Just a quick follow-up question. I know we've in past had discussions about you're very involved with the Emerging Nations program and coaching development on the youth side of things. And I know we've spoken in the past about having being able to give some exposure, even in discussion, to some of the coaches that are participating in those ENPs. Is that still ongoing? And do you think there's a way we can collaborate between committees even more to help grow at a grassroots level? It's somewhat the sharing of these same coaches and their knowledge across, you know, both disciplines, so to speak, parasailing and able-bodied sailing.
Yes, Betsy, as you say, we've discussed this quite often before, and I think it is very important, especially in the learn to sail environment, so our instructor area, that we really do a lot of education. And we do have a module within our technical courses for coaches on teaching people with disabilities and how to just get started, really, and get things going. So we do have that module. I think what Palermo highlighted for me is that we need to take this into our performance coaching realm. And it was also, Massimo mentioned the 10 coaches from Greece that came out. Now, they are all coaches from various clubs around the country in Greece. And I spent quite a bit of time talking to them about the differences in coaching. And as I said, we try and make those differences as little as possible. But they're very excited about doing this. And I think we need to be looking at our performance side more, and how we combine, how we bring in modules on teaching people with disabilities as well as standard coaching. So, and not only teaching, but coaching. So taking it to the next level. I think one of the challenges is the boats, because we've got quite a wide variety of boats. And again, the whole thing of a joystick as opposed to a tiller and that sort of thing, we've got to teach the coaches how to teach that differently, but yet keep the precision in what you're coaching. So The other area is the difference between people. You might get someone, like I had someone without arms sailing a Liberty, but without a servo. And then you have someone who's got one hand, and you've got someone who is a quadriplegic or a paraplegic, and how to still keep that high level of we want you to do a thing as best as you possibly can do it, and working on those, that precision in training, rather than just saying, look, we're going to just do it. We're just getting you around the course. So I think emphasizing that where a normal coach would look at a situation and see where they can improve, they need to carry that through in all levels of sailing. And so to answer your question, yes, we definitely need to collaborate a bit more and see. I would love to speak to coaches who have coached on a very high level in the para environment so that I can be sure that what I'm saying is correct. But because I've just evolved on my own with in outside of the Paralympic sort of environment. So it's a different type of coaches. But I think we need to, on the performance side, really need to collaborate and develop something a bit further.
Thank you for those comments. I think they're really important. We also had a couple of comments come into the chat box, one from Sophia, who said she agrees with you. She was there coaching the Greek team and need to find more ways to help develop the knowledge of the sailors. And I don't think this is just unique in parasailing. It's the same when you've got able-bodied people that are just starting in the sport and learning. So it's really taking those same concepts and thinking of how we apply it across the board. And I would agree, the one difference when you come into parasailing is we're trying to get those people up to speed more quickly because there hasn't been a tremendous pipeline before the PDP clinics. And the other point that was just made by Michael Geerling from the RS class is there's been a message that's been circulated by Dan Jaspers on RS participation and events at The Hague before the combined world championship in 2023. And the thought is, could we organize a PDP, at The Hague in the next 20 months before that championship to do a PDP in double-handed supplied equipment. And again, this is going to have to go to the committee and look at budgeting and whatnot, but that may be an opportunity to have some supplied equipment by the venture class that people would become more familiar with. Rob, you have a comment?
Yes, Betsy, I think I just wanted to highlight the difference in the different classes we're working with. The Hansa is specifically a class where I think we need to do more development, because it is a class where that is a gateway class, if I can call it that. And I think looking at the 303 Worlds, we got a lot of new people that haven't been to championships before, that can hardly sail, that sort of thing. And perhaps we need to do a bit more on have rule seminars at these events, have talks and chats in after racing about how to rig a 303 better or whatever the case may be, but treating it as a development class in that we are running at the event, during the event, not as a PDP, but during the event, running seminars on, evening seminars on rules and on how to rig the boat better, how to sail the boat better, whatever the case may be. And I think that might be something that's specific to the 303 class.
Yeah, Betsy, if I can add something about Michel and their sailing, I think there is an opportunity, as I told, next year. There is a week in which we can have a test event and training in The Hague just a year before the event. So we can consider the first week of August having something with different classes. And if their adventure is able to it's able to provide equipment, even with Servo, it would be great. And we will be very happy to have a PDP there, because usually the main issue for a PDP is having the equipment. If we have the equipment, we already did a big step, and we'd be good inviting sailors there. So more than happy to arrange something with that adventure.
Great. Well, let's have a discussion outside of this, and we'll try to make something happen there. And thank you to RS for your support and your suggestions on this. Anybody else have any questions for Rob or Massimo on PDPs and ongoing work in that respect? Well, great. Thank you again, Rob, for all your work on this. We really appreciate your energy and enthusiasm and support for this aspect of the sport, and it does make a difference. So thank you.
Thank you very much for having me.
Pleasure. Massimo, you were trying to speak.
We have Emily and Ruth from the Mallory Group now that they just joined.
Great. Well, welcome, Ruth and Emily. We will now jump back to agenda item 3C. We would love to have you give us an update on what has been happening from the Mallory Group with regard to Paralympics and re-inclusion for 2020. Sorry.
Great. Thanks very much, Betsy. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Great. And I'm hoping to present to you. So actually, I've just got to do a little systems preferences thing. Apologies to allow it to screen share. Sorry. I'm going to have to restart my computer. Ruth, you hold the floor. I'm coming straight back.
Okay. Can you hear me okay? Yeah. Is my sound okay for you guys?
Yes,
we can hear you.
Oh, fantastic. Yeah, so I'll wait for Emily to come in. I won't steal the show. But yeah, we had a really successful 24 hours. We're really pleased with the outcome, pleased with the results that we've generated on behalf of World Sailing, but also seeing this massive backing outside of the media coverage, but on social media. And also we have seen local pickup as well. But generally speaking, lots of user-generated content on social media, which is a big sign from individuals that they really feel strongly about it, that they feel so strongly that they've created their own content using our references. So the correct hashtags are on the post, some great images are on there. So there's been lots of sharing of content that we've created. But when people actually go ahead and post something brand new using our messaging, it means that they really care about it. And there's some really high profile people doing that in the global sailing community. So we're going to show some examples of that in this call. But we feel that that first stage has been really successful. The media have really got behind it as well, which is something they genuinely feel really strongly about. I think Reuters, head of global sport, who I know really well, was messaging me last night saying it's pinned to our sports page, meaning all of Reuters' clients can see it and it's prioritized over other global sports coverage. So it's something that people are believing in, which is really important and really nice to see, because I think you guys work so hard to promote this, and it's nice that everyone seems to be behind it. We haven't seen anyone in the community being negative about this decision, which is sometimes a real concern when you spend a lot of time promoting something and someone in your own community doesn't back it, which is just always a big disappointment. And this isn't happening in sailing, which is a really good from what we can see. So yeah, we'll go through the top line results, but then also go through what we feel should be the next stages after this launch.
Can you see my screen, everyone, with a Paralympic Sailing Reinstatement Launch Update slide?
Yes.
Hooray, thank you, apologies for that. And can you see campaign rationale on the slides moving through?
Yes.
So we just wanted to do a quick recap for you to remind everybody why we were doing this campaign. And the first point was we need to launch this. We need to launch the fact that World Sailing wants to have the reinstatement of sailing back for LA28. So it's to grab the attention of the IPC, our key stakeholders and partners, and also the global sailing community, supporting organisations, as well as the media. We want to create impact now, and particularly now while the IPC is deciding on the criterion process for the sports, which sports are going to be included. We wanted to show the IPC that we as the sailing community should can speak with one voice, and that one voice is all speaking around this reinstatement. It's about